peace and mercy to all of us here today from God our Father, from the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And here we are, together. Martin Luther would be proud. The occasion for this, of course, is the 500th anniversary of the Lutheran Reformation. 500 years ago, Luther started this thing called Reformation. Pastor Grabenhaus and I recognize that some of you weren't even here. And so as young pastors decided that it would be helpful and thoughtful and inspiring and fun for us to get together and worship. Not as easy as we had hoped. Was it done? Not an easy thing. I want to have taken some notes for my congregation back at St. Paul's after I put this together. Notes to self. Note number one, mandatory liturgy refresher course. Nobody gets a ham dinner ticket until you get your diploma. And I'm thinking, Doug, maybe you can be our guest instructor. You can come over and teach us that liturgy once again. Refresh us to what has been so rich in our lives. And I thought maybe an optional course, sort of an upper level course in Lutheran hymns of the Lutheran hymnal. And we would give you an advanced degree, an advanced membership degree, if you can sing them correctly, which of course would be in German. And then, note to self, patience and understanding. Be nice if we could get this in a pill. That we could take two of these pills, patience and understanding, before getting together. Because it's not easy leaving your comfort zone. It's not easy giving up what you're used to and comfortable in. It's not easy coming together, even as Christians. It's not easy for people at Grace to open up your doors and welcome us and even be nice to the people who are sitting in your seat. So patience and understanding is required when we come together. But by the grace of God, we have come together. And Luther would be happy. And Jesus would be happy. Because he calls us to unity. And this is the base for our worship today. The gospel is a beautiful picture, really, of our life together as fellow believers. Two disciples are together on the same road on the way to Emmaus after the history-changing events that had happened in Jerusalem. And I would describe those two Lutherans as prehistoric Missouri Synod Lutherans. And I say that because our word synod actually comes from a Greek word that means the same road. And it's this idea of us walking together, disciples, walking together on the same road. And these disciples were on the same road, and our life together as Lutherans is really Christians, disciples on the same road, approaching God in the same way, looking at what he's done for us in the same way. And these were really sort of the prototype Lutherans, two disciples walking on the same way. And the other thing the text shows us that is sort of evidential for us that these may have been our forerunners is that the text says that they were walking and talking as they were on the same road. But actually the text, the way the text describes it, that they were not just walking and talking, but that they were vigorously debating. The Greek word is very sort of direct and intense. That they weren't just talking, they were talking with energized enthusiasm and opinions about what had happened in Jerusalem. Ergo, hence, I believe that they were our prototypes, our forefathers, right? What were they debating? What were they so vigorous about? What were they so opinionated about? Was it page 5 or 15? Was it hymns or praise songs? Was it the color of the carpet? Was it the strength of the coffee? No, what they were opinionated about, what they were energized about, was what they were discussing vigorously with one another on the road, was everything that had happened in Jerusalem. Everything that had happened. So in the immortal words of Martin Luther, they were vigorously debating, what does this mean? What does this mean that Jesus entered Jerusalem triumphantly with palm branches at his feet and cloaks on the road and children singing, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. He came on a donkey, which they would have known was a messianic sign. The king was coming, and he was coming with humility and peace. What does this mean? What does it mean that the very next day he overturned the tables of the temple and enraged and infuriated the religious leaders of his day? Seem to be saying that hundreds of years of tradition and good liturgy aren't enough to enter the kingdom of God. What does that mean to us? What does it mean that he ate with sinners? And that he welcomed a known sinner to come and anoint his feet with expensive perfume and dry them with her hair? What does it mean that Jesus washed his disciples' feet and broke bread with them and showed them in the simplest examples and terms possible what it meant to be a disciple, to love one another, to serve one another with humility, compassion, and grace? What does it mean that it was one of our own who betrayed him? And that when push came to shove, when the heat was turned up, the disciples, people who had confessed him as the Christ, the Son of the living God, abandoned him when he needed them the most. What does it mean that he suffered under Pontius Pilate, that he was crucified, died, and buried? What does it mean that these women are now telling us this amazing story, that they went to the tomb early in the morning, and that he is not there, and that he is risen from the dead? What does that mean? You see, the truth of the matter is, they didn't know what we know. That Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from all eternity, a true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord, who has redeemed me, a lost and condemned person, purchased and won me from all sin and death and the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood, and innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own, live under him in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he has risen from the dead, lives and reigns to all eternity. You guys all know that, right? Everybody knows that, right? This is most certainly true. How could they not know that? And our text tells us that they were kept from knowing, or they were kept from recognizing him. By what? By the same things that I suppose keep you and me from recognizing him. Our sin, our doubt, our fear, our insecurity, our pride, our preoccupation with the debate of minor things. Enter the risen Lord Jesus. And he appears to these disciples on the same road, these pre-Lutheran Lutherans struggling with the meaning of it all. He appears with grace and walks with them, and it is truly a beautiful and complete picture of our life together. We are sitting, we are on the same road with Jesus, who is present to us and for us, helping us recognize the meaning of everything that has happened. And there is a wow verse today, if I've ever read it. Luke chapter 24, verse 37, it says, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in the scriptures concerning himself. Wow. Wouldn't you want to be on the same road that day with Jesus for that conversation? When he explains to you everything that was ever written in the Word of God concerning himself, wouldn't you want to know? Wouldn't you want to hear what he has to say? So here's the encouragement to us. Here's the good news for us today. We wish we were there. We are here. We are here. Just some disciples walking together, sitting together. Right? An amazing thing. Can't walk together if you can't sit together. And Jesus is here in our midst, in his word. And every week that word of God is read for you and explain to you and proclaim over you that Jesus is the center of it all, that it all points to him. He is the hope of your life, hope that you're looking for, and the Savior that you need. And perhaps the best means that we'll have to recognize him today and his presence in our midst that's already been mentioned is going to be in the breaking of the bread, which we'll share together in a moment. And Jesus has promised to be in that and with that and under that. He promises to place his sinless self into our sinless hands to remind us of everything that has happened, that all that happens, happened for you. That he was given for you. That his blood was shed for you. For the remission of your sins. So that you and I might depart from this place in this peace. So here we are. Together. It is a wonderful thing. We've been doing this for a while now. We go way back. As Lutherans, not just 500 years, but farther. We go back to those two disciples on the road to Emmaus. We go back to those early Christians who were built on the foundation of the prophets and the apostles, with Jesus Christ as our cornerstone. And the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ and his power over sin and death and the power of the devil has been proclaimed in our churches and in our pulpits. And whenever that happens, God starts bringing people together, rich and poor, Gentiles and Greeks, slaves and free, males and females, Scythians, barbarians, Pulvilians, Brawlians, Alcentrians, whatever you choose to call yourselves, he brings them together. And he is bringing us together. So thank God and praise God that we are sitting here together. We are singing here together. We are confessing together. We are growing together. We are loving together, serving together,